talk, 231 talk. This will be very practical. So I know there's a couple of people standing in the back, or people that do not have laptops, or people that are on Facebook. If you're in here to learn and actually do something today, get off Facebook. Or if you do not have a laptop with you, then get one. If you need any chargers, we're all friends. I'm sure that other people have Dells, other people have Macs. I have extra chargers if y'all need some. Just letting y'all know that it is very hands-on. If y'all have any questions or if you're confused, I'm working at Dell Space. So any questions that you have, feel free to stop me. In the meantime, if y'all do not have the Node runtime, then go to nodejs.org and just download on either one of the downloads. You know, it's edgy, it's pretty bad, it's really stable, but it's not as fixed. You can use either one of those downloads and it will work that day. Go to nodejs.org. You can, like I said, you can download either one, both of them will work. So what are we going to be doing today? Basically, this is the application display. I know for y'all those who are like, man, this is a hackathon, this is very great. It's because it works. And that's going to be where the emphasis on today. Basically, you just have a small like voting app, and then you click a button, you can actually cast a vote. Now, it looks very simple, and actually I think it's just a little bit. But the difference that you see here is something you can't see, and it's the fact that it's actually meant to be able to try and see. And actually, every single time you actually push the side of it, it's going to click the vote button. It doesn't just update that number, it's no plus plus going on. It actually goes to a Firebase database, and then a Firebase database actually pulls all the current votes. Now, does anybody, can anybody tell me why, whenever I click one of the buttons, why I would actually query the database for all of the votes? If the database is shared? Some of those votes. So by the end of this, class, we'll all be actually casting votes to the same application. And the vote count that you see here was on the top right here that actually raised it up. So these are actually votes from that. That's the really cool thing that's going on. I did have a PowerPoint to show some of the high-level concepts, but I guess due to technical difficulties, we will have to not skip. skip that portion, but it'll be a little more theoretical. So what I asked y'all to do initially was to go to nodejs.org and to download one of these things. What it's actually installing is two different things. One is going to be installing Node, and another thing is going to be installing this property thing. These are both what they call CLIs. CLI stands for a command line interface. Basically, what CLI is a way of, it's like a small focused package of abilities and features, right? So whenever we're doing node-like things, then we want to use the node CLI or the CLI to do node-like stuff. Now, the difference between the node CLI and they're both used via the terminal. Now, the difference between the node CLI and the NPM CLI is that NPM stands for the node package manager. So what that means is that you can actually coordinate node packages in here. So what does that mean? Does that mean I'm just going to go and get a bunch of Node.js applications and install them? Not necessarily. It's just, it could be projects, it could be tools, it could be any other things, it could be APIs. But the thing is that those programs are used via Node, or if somebody cracks the C++ underlying the electrical things. So you're going to use the NPM CLI to install things. And today we'll stand to the dependencies of the client. So the other place that we need to go is to if you go to GitHub and you search Matt.Nolan and go to all GitHub. And then from there you go to users. And then you go to my profile, and you go to the thing, most of the JavaScript thing. And then you go to, maybe it might be the top right, @rice8_module1. It says module 1, so I'm going to make it separate repos. So you have three different modules inside of that repository. If you do not have Git on your laptops, then that's okay. You can click the Chrome download and just download the zip. If you do have Git, then just Git Chrome this repository. And thumbs up whenever y'all have Chrome. Here. Did we start essentially, what this is what they call a script tag is just a way to reference other JavaScript files, or to reference JavaScript files, but this is an HTML file. The script tag can reference things that are on the web, or it can reference things that are on the web, which technically is still on the web, and it's just a different way that you link to it, right? So if you were to link to something that's like http://, maybe you're going to like google.com, whereas if you were to link to something like, you know, /images/tags, right? That's like your local image that's getting to by the tag. So that could vary, and I don't want to really get into that, but what I do want to say is that the script tag, what it's doing is on the fly, kind of downloading and putting in your website the Firebase library, right? So if we want to do Firebase-like things on our website, then we need Firebase. Does that make sense? And then what is Firebase? Right? So Firebase is a database that's in the cloud, and all in the cloud means that it's hosted, but you don't have to host it, right? So if you ever take a database course, you might use like admin or something, or like LAMP, or whatever. You might have downloaded some collection of things, Stack Overflow until it worked. But all of that stuff is actually offloaded to Firebase, the company, and Firebase is actually now owned by Google. And so the cool thing about it is that one, it's hosted, so you don't have to set it up. And then two, it's NoSQL. That's a cool thing, also a very dangerous thing. There's a difference between SQL databases and NoSQL databases. At a very, very high level, you can think of a SQL database as something that's very structured, right? So like on this wall, there's like a periodic table lineup, people on the left can see it, right? And there's a certain reason that each element sits by the other element, right? And it's very planned out and very thought forward for you, and there's a structure in place where you can't. Whereas a NoSQL database, you can have a table, but it's not good to think about a table, because you think of a table, you think of Excel, you think of columns, and once you define this column, you can't really break out the column, so you can add a new column. Or NoSQL databases, once you have essentially an Excel table, every single row has its own columns. So it would be smart of you to keep the columns synced, right? Like you keep any row of information you add to your database similar, but you don't have to. So what that could mean for your customers is like, what if I want to open up my own ice cream shop? Or what if I want to make my own ice cream shop supporting website where new people that open up ice cream stores want to come in and add it on my platform, right? Like a DVD or WordPress or GoDaddy, that kind of stuff, right? Well, if they want to add their flavors and they had flavor categories, right? Like sweet stuff, maybe they have savory ice cream, maybe they have bacon in the ice cream or something like that. You don't want to have to add a new table every single time. Then you can use a NoSQL database if you have to use that without flexing. It also means it's very dangerous, right? Designing around a NoSQL database can be very difficult. You can actually make it inefficient, more like less efficient for your actual instance. So, but we're going to use Firebase for now, and we're going to use that as a database because it's pretty easy to set up, and especially in the hackathon world, you want to try to get you want to get something working kind of quickly. Also, you want to make it look good. So what we're going to do is we're for now just going to have the link for the Firebase library to pull it into our app if you want to do it that way, and then we're going to set up the link. So if we go to Firebase.google.com. This really cool website with like all of this stuff, and there's like all this marketing stuff. We're going to skip all of it. I believe they have a sign-in with like they sign in with Gmail. So if you will, if in the top right, I don't know what it says for that. I'm sure there's something that says sign-in by any means. Sorry, it's probably up there. You guys see what it says, the Firebase that we were on for y'all. Go ahead and sign in. Or go on sign up. Oh. Then if that's the case, then you just click the Go to Console button at the top right. So an awesome, cool, huge website, and we're just going to put that by a three-letter word in the top right. Because we know exactly what we're doing. So, what the code, I have a mic integration also to where we try to bring out together. But if in the future or even later on in the Python, you get this cool website and you want to build up some database, you can use Firebase. Like right after this one. And in fact, if you have any questions, come up and ask me a question. You did it and you're super excited about it. So we're going to click add project, and then we're just going to give it a project name. And we'll call it some project. And then you accept the terms where you sign your library with Google, and then you create a project. And then whenever that valve is finished spinning, then you will have already created a Firebase project. And so what does that mean? Firebase has a lot of marketing, obviously, from all these different apps. Firebase actually has a lot of tools around the database. There's a lot of things that you want to set up whether you're starting a new website, whether it be in Firebase or Python, right? If you want to use some notification, like if you want to onboard your views for the registration, those things happen every single website. So Firebase has like tools and features that actually like help you set this stuff up without having to actually write the code every single time. Right? You just want to get it done. Maybe you got a contract and you're trying to make some money. So it's just getting to do it and doing that. Right? But what we're going to be focusing on is under develop, you can click the database. So in the database, we have even more marketing tasks. We'll be skipping all that too. We're actually going to click the button that says create database. Now there's this new beta thing called Cloud Firestore that is outside of the scope of this talk. We will be just focusing on the actual database. We like extra stuff, we like stuff that makes sense, that works, and that you can just make a quick buck off of. So we're going to click create database, and then we're just going to just roll out following the rules. Right after that, we're just going to not use the Cloud Firestore. So they created a Cloud Firestore. We're like, wow, that is so cool. Site. You click the button that says Cloud Firestore at the top and you switch over to what kind of it is. And that's just a good standard. Anybody lost? Any questions? Anybody? So now we have a real-time database. There's nothing in it. There's no tables. There's no columns. You know, somebody told me that databases were like this Excel-like thing. Like, wow, what's actually going on? There's nothing in it. So like I was saying before, Firebase is a NoSQL database, so there's really no like idea of tables. It's better to think of Firebase like NoSQL database is almost as buckets. So you can define what different buckets that you want to support. And then you can put buckets within those buckets, and then buckets within those buckets, and then eventually you set that. Right. So that's where designing it is kind of hard, because you have to have a huge imagination. You have to be very cognizant on what you're trying to produce. Right. So if you all have ever seen like at Christmas time, like there's like Russian dolls, there's like dolls, like that, so on. So that's like basically the Firebase database. So we start off and like essentially this node is like the entire database. Buckets inside of those, and then make more columns or tables inside of that, and put it together. So as you see right here, if we just click this plus button, then we can define our first bucket one, and then we give a value of 10. And essentially, what we have done here is we have a bucket that we call bucket one, and it doesn't actually have any tables; it just has a value, right? It just has a value of 10. So if we were to later query on that bucket name, we wouldn't actually get the whole table. In that case, we would actually just get one value. And that's very strange to y'all. Anybody that might have this experience, because you might be used to saying, I want to get something from this table, and you get all these different columns. Right? Again, it's a different way of thinking. So what happens if I want to treat a bucket as a table? Right? And I can go in, I can click plus again, give it a bucket, and then I can hit the plus sign and then make a message feature, right? So then this one can say if we were to actually query on bucket one, we would get two different rows of data, each row being cat one, cat two, and the value being one. And as you can see, like, okay, maybe this is starting to grow more, but it's only nested more and more and more and more. So, as you can, and also as you can see, everything's key value pairs, right? So maybe you think key value pairs, you think of two things. Maybe you think of YAML, or maybe you think of JSON. And so that's kind of a better way to start thinking about the kind of tables you want. Structure and a general idea of what kind of bucket do you want, what kind of structure you want in it, and then start with the JSON structure first, and then work backwards to a bucket. And then that's a good way to actually go about designing, if you want to design a NoSQL database from, if you have like a SQL. Is that clear? So in this case,
I don't have an app, so I can't manage.
So if you click on the rules column or the rules tab, you click on that and tell me what you see there.
You have to hover the yellow and add another one, add back the one again, and then it'll change it.
The yellow switch to real time database to at the top. Values on any key, same as JSON, can be a static value, whether that be like a number or a string, or it could be just another object. So, you know, dumbing down, it's just like another object. So if you are setting something to like a hard value, at that point in time, it can no longer be an object, so you have to override that value. Any other questions? Did that help? Okay. Cool. Okay, so how do I actually use this database now? So I don't really know why it was structured as such. But again, this is probably, you're probably too powerful like all of my people on the rest. But you have to go all the way back to the authentication button. You're going to click there, and then you click web setup. And then it actually just bam gives you the full JavaScript for your database. Right? So I don't know if that helps. As you can see there in my project ID, it actually has my project name in it, or whatever project you called it. The storage bucket, which is essentially where your database is at, has a store project right here. So it's actually already configured, and you can see this first script tag here, it has that library thing that was talking about earlier, that pulls in the Firebase library. So I would like to say it was harder than copying and pasting this into your application and it working, but it's actually just that easy. So we have the code. So before we were in the database, in our local database, and then you just go up and click authentication, and you have to click website. So as with anything, technology these days is pretty easy. It's built to make your life easier. It's just sometimes the process and you know, the swarm of ads can get very daunting. So I hope that helps get on to that point. So is that clear? Is everyone good? Everyone on the laptop? People on laptops that are somehow competing. Yeah, handwriting. Yeah, handwriting hacks is probably going to be the next. So we're just going to go back to the code here and just kind of go through idea of line 33. Can I see the line number? I wear glasses, and I know there's a lot of people that wear glasses because everyone's playing Fortnite and League of Legends. So, it is line 33. Because we got this library into our application, what it did was it gave me this very nice, convenient Firebase word. It is essentially an object that holds some methods in it. One of the methods being, as you see on line 44, initialize apps. So we're just going to take this configuration that we've been using, this copy paste from the website, and put it into the initialize app, and then it will have initialize our app. So from then, because we just loaded up the page, maybe we add some votes from it. So as you can see in line 45, I have a function in here called refresh all votes. So I took the context of my Firebase application that I got back as a return from the initialize app, and I set it to this FB variable. And then down here in professional votes, you can see we want to get the Firebase database because we configured it, but it's just a context, so we haven't actually activated anything. And then we want to get that reference by calling that database. It's just a lot of boilerplate. That is actually doing stuff, but it's stuff that you don't really care. Just see that, well, okay, I need to get this reference because I want to create something. And then we call .ref to actually get the entire database. We only want to get it once to get its value. There's a whole another talk about, or a deeper discussion about promises versus RCS. I don't know if anybody can hear us React or does Angular or if not, then it basically, whenever we call dot once, we get this follow-up and call it out again. All it does is whenever it's ready, then it will give us the value. That value will then be saved in a snapshot variable. So there's a lot of kind of magic going on here, but just stay focused on what the goal might be, right? And that is, we get the whole database, well, we get the database reference, so we're saying like we're ready to start using the database, and then we want to get the whole database by just calling .ref, and we get the database's contents. And then we wanted to be able to talk as whatever it's done getting that whole database, so we double up on .once and .then. And the technique here where I'm just like .this, that's called method chain. If you ever get a class or ever seen any type of class where every single method in it returns itself, or this, then that allows you. So essentially what happens is we call a method, it does what it needs to do, and then we kind of get this context back. And then from that context, we just call the method. Instead of having to say like FB equals, so that just looks a little bit sloppy. I don't know if this looks cleaner at all. So from there, we get the snapshot, .bell, and then there's some other JavaScript magic. Essentially, what you see is that it's floating through the whole database, and we're going to be getting each one of those values back. So, it gives us a style, and then we set it to our database. So, some of this is a little bit out of scope of thoughtfulness, unless y'all really want to learn JavaScript real quick. But essentially, what it's doing is getting the database. Now, in line 65, there's nothing inside of that method call. I know that it's, there's probably a question out there like, well, then how do we know that it's getting the whole database? So what that ref does is it actually does take one parameter, it's a functional parameter called a path, and that path will actually get you to whatever bucket that you're trying to specify. So as you can see in one of these other method calls, if I want to get the current row, like in this method, I do kind of the same set of operations. I do fb.get the database reference, but in this time, you want to get that votes value. So here I have a parameter for my whole function called vote option name, and it's going to be a string, and then I pass that into that ref, and that's going to give me that path. That path is the path that votes. So why, when I pass that path, am I just thinking about the then this is not the database. That's how much you keep track of the database. Right? I could probably express it a little bit better if you wanted to actually a full Strawpoll or a full voting app. Surveys, if you will, and then how many surveys you have the different IDs, right? Survey like 71, 72, 73, 74. And I already got, I have all the books. But here, just keeping it simple, I have idea one, I have idea two, and I have idea three. Is there any questions on how this database is set up, or how Firebase is set up? Is everything clear, or is it like, again, some of the process things where I just skip over the margin stuff is just because that's what you do anyway. Essentially, whenever you try to learn something new, you'll probably spend, I don't know, a few hours just trying to figure out what button presses and what presses are really easy. So I'm just trying to say that this is what you would normally do if you were starting to fire this application. And this is the immediate steps. So there's no actual, there's no more magic in this. I just set up a quick database. I made three keys, or what we call keys, and I did this on the rails. And I just, idea one, idea two, idea three. And then what I'm doing is, I would take one of those paths, like the path that just in the string that says idea one. I would call dot ref at that string that is idea one. And then whenever I do dot once and then dot then, its value would be the current value. So every first start of your application, it would be zero. You would take it, take it down, plus plus it, and then just push it back up. So there's a couple of other methods in here in Firebase that are kind of deemed here, like dot set, and that's one where I can push an invoke. For a dot ref, if I had a string that was idea one or idea two, and I had an actual vote count, like some number that I'm trying to push, I would then get that path, which is like idea one, and then I would call dot set, and I would set this value. So I'm referencing the key, and then I'm pushing. Is that straightforward? So that's kind of it for module one. Now we can host this thing. There's two different ways you can host it. You can host it, there's two different tools that you can use, and it's based off of what you want to use, but you can install both with npm. If you go and you search npm HTTP server, and then you just click the first one, you'll see this. npm.js.com with like this turtle with a rocket on its back. And then there's a cool, there's a one line here where you can install the HTTP server. This is a node based, what they call simple server. So if you've ever used like MANP, any of those are like bigger, what they call application servers. There's a difference between like a server and like an application server. Like a server could just be like a desktop you can just put it on your house, right? Where you can put it in it and now it doesn't mean like things. An application server is something that has a context for a particular application and maybe comes with might say module 1, 2, 3, click in there, and then you click on module 1, and click press me. That is just going to mount my number. Thumbs up whenever you all are.
Can you scroll it up last time again?
Sure. Finding this guy?
No, afterwards. After you install it.
Okay, so then let me just control it. I don't know if you want to go to the Linux one. The Linux talk. You just run PWD if you're on a Linux like machine on Mac, and it'll show you your current path. You just went to C or into the directory that you're currently at. If you're on a Windows machine and you are using an app or PIR, actually this is the current directory, so you use LS like way on, so I'm not a browser. If I just like LS and I see module 1, 2, 3, and then I can just use C to change the directory and go into module 1. And then from there I just run to the HTTP lecture. So the really cool thing is that npm itself is a CLI, and then we're going to use npm to install the simple server CLI, which we call HTTP. Does that make sense? So you're using the npm, which is a node package manager, to install the package. But that new package that you're installing is another CLI. And that CLI is solely focused on serving websites. Static websites. HTML stuff. So that's how you host it locally. And then once you're there, you can just go open the tab and do localhost. Go on V80 and then go to the HTML page and then click the vote button, which should work. And then once I refresh, I'll get the votes. If you are voting for JD or Alan Bryce and IP, and then you can see the votes go up. So, and likewise, on all your machines, if you refresh your page, you refresh your vote, and you'll see that go up. So now we've posted a static website locally. Now, we're going to skip internet because there's no company here, and we can host it straight to the internet. There's a lot of cool ways to do that, but I'm going to use another very simple tool called Surge. And I use this for a lot of my hackathons myself. If you go to surge.sh, it's another tool that you can install. It's another CLI that you can install using the npm CLI, and it will host static websites to the internet. And one command. So if you go to npm, or you run npm install -global, or just add keep, and then search, it'll get that CLI. And then once you're done with that, then you just stop to your parent program, you can see everything. So Windows Control C, or maybe Control Z, and then Mac, still Control C. And then you just run search instead, and then she'll not ask you to put it on your maybe an email or gives you, it just makes up a name for you, and then you copy it. Go to your browser. I can share it on Facebook and then, you know, get like likes, get a couple of likes, get comments, and then maybe post it. So, now, past this, that's just how you host like any static website. The next part of this application, or next part of this talk, which I'll just go over very briefly because I'm only 15 minutes long, is the Angular CLI. Again, it's another CLI. I know you guys are like, man, it's so much like my terminal. Like, what can I actually use my mouse? The Angular CLI is a CLI for creating Angular applications. There's a lot of boilerplate, so if anyone's interested, I can go through some of the boilerplate. If y'all are not, then I can just parts of your application. I know the password here has this drawn off of Ruby on Rails. We know that we're on Ruby on Rails. The cool thing about Ruby on Rails is that it also does scaffolding. It was one of like the first frameworks to do scaffolding. Because people were like, well, we constantly need to make new pages, and maybe we constantly need to make like logical pieces, like I need to put my JavaScript somewhere. And all of a sudden, because this massive spaghetti code, that I need this huge website, I don't even know how I can get this thing, I'm so lost. I need to be able to organize it, and also to not have to type everything, because I've used my wrist for Fortnite and Legends, and I'll just shot. So I need to just generate files for me. And that's kind of what Ruby on Rails started doing. That's where you were able to create programs really quickly. And now CLIs are just kind of everywhere to the scaffold. What they call the scaffold is kind of an application. So in Angular, it's called the Angular CLI. In React, there's two. There's create React app, and then there's the create React native app. And that's how you make the mobile apps in React. So with the Angular CLI, not only can you say ng new, but you can also use to serve the application. So if you were to install the CLI, again, for sake of time, I think I'd not do that. But if I go into that module, and I just want to serve, while this is going, and I'm trying so hard not to embarrass myself, are there any general questions on Firebase or the application? Or do y'all actually feel like y'all got something out of this? Do y'all understand more of what the database is and kind of what we're using it for?
Yes, I have a cool question. What was the unique kink serve thing?
Yes, so whenever you serve, oh, it's actually built this time, so y'all just believe me that it works. I'm just going to stop it and answer this question. Yeah, it's an algorithm version on there. And you can see the same app, but now it's a new app. So, is that Angular context? So, back to this question. If I do surge, if you just run surge, there are surge command arguments. If you're doing arguments on the command line, typically there's kind of like this dash like notation and then some other value. It's kind of like a key value pair. So I think if you do like dash key domain, you can actually like specify cats rs or something like that, and then it'll give you some catrs.serve.sh. But if you don't, because you really don't care, you just want on the internet, and you hit enter, it'll actually just generate a random domain for you. Right? So I did that thing, I hit enter, and then it'll actually tell you what the domain is. Patricia's-button. Does that make sense? So I really didn't like pick it, it just gave me. Later, you know, once we have work on making millions of other people, we can go and get a real domain. Here we just put that in the URL and the website was SD.html and then the source. And it's on your own, so like y'all can even go to Python and stuff like that. So, some basic concept of that, right?
So, it's about the animated in the test loop on HTML.
Oh, okay. Is testv.html. Which is, so I don't know if I should, if y'all caught the concepts here, and the code's there if you ever want to read through it. If you have interest in, maybe not even necessarily the front end, but JavaScript, I'm a pretty big JavaScript guy, so I've walked through the code a little bit. I'm using a lot of what they call like ES6 stuff, which is like more of a modern JavaScript. So it has some convenient stuff in here, like, you know, that, you know, code reach and this stuff and stuff like that. But it could be helpful for people too. So the basic concept that we covered here was how to create your own database. How do you add it to your website, right? It's still there in a happy place. But you've got to make sure you build all the publication on the website. How do you actually initialize, how do you actually tell your website that you want to start using, or that you maybe even want to set up a configuration for that particular database that you want to connect to? And then after that, how do you actually tell Firebase or tell the Firebase library that, hey, how much are you using Firebase now? Database. And then how do I do the whole database versus like how I would do something like this? Like I will want it. And then it'll get that bucket. In this case, that bucket is only one value. In the future, that bucket could be the entire database itself. What that looks like. So and that's kind of like the basic idea. And I covered CLIs. So we went to Node.js.org. We hit download node. We got two different CLIs. One I did cover called just node, which is technically a different terminal. Right now, actually, it would do things. But we covered using npm, which is an edit manager, or edit manager, or it's something that found with tags is. If you ever use Linux, then you might see like a package manager that acts like a program that says, you know, let me go here, put this in the package. The npm package manager is CLI based, it's terminal based. So we use the terminal to install things. And then we use the npm install command. Help us generate and scaffold or template up a bunch of different CLI. Again, we use the CLI and saw other CLI actually posted both on the local web, which is your computer, but also on the internet. Any other questions? Very cool. Applause if it was helpful. For this talk, because we want to get all the stuff, and all these white boxes are pre-shirts. So if you're on the web, then just imagine you putting on a Capital One shirt. It feels so good. But if you're here, you actually get one.